Today we'll be discussing from IJPP, Indian Journal of Practical Pediatrics 2020, Hemato-Oncology Edition, discussing nutritional anemia, strategy for prevention and management, and also we'll try to cover autoimmune hemolytic anemia. If time permits, by that I mean if my son permits, we'll try to cover our leukemia advances and updates that's given in this paper. So let's get started. Hope all of you have your journals with you, have your pen and paper with you in case you need to attach some notes or write some notes in your journal. So nutritional anemia. So if the same topic is asked as a question, nutritional anemia, strategy for prevention and management. So you start with an introduction. What will you start with? What is anemia? Anemia, simplest definition you can give is a qualitative and quantitative reduction in the hemoglobin. Dr. Lekat, yes, I understand clinical examination you want me to teach. See, without patients, it's very difficult to teach a clinical examination. If some of you are ready to present cases, yes, I'd be ready to take up that. We can discuss what sort of questions will be asked in a case presentation and we can take it from there. But clinical demonstrations per se will be very difficult. Okay, so rest, I'm ready to teach you. So we will see how to go about that. So if you guys have any idea, please let me know in our Telegram group. We will think about how to discuss clinical cases also. So coming back to this, nutritional anemia, if such a topic is asked, start with an introduction or a definition which states a qualitative or quantitative reduction in hemoglobin is considered as anemia. All right. So what is the importance of anemia in India? India accounts for nearly 40%. So among global cases, 40% of anemia are present in India. And in India, if you see in various age groups, roughly 50%. Okay, so less than 5 years, 60% of the kids are anemic. Above 5 years, your 15 years, your women in reproductive age group, 50% are anemic. Simpler, you remember. Don't remember 58, 49, 50%, 60%. So less than 6 years, 60%. More than 6 years, 50%. Simple. And what is the importance of correcting an anemia? Why are we worried about it? Anemia, if it is going to be prevalent, it's going to reduce the cognition, reduce the oxygen carrying capacity, reduce the physical stamina, reduce the playfulness of the child. Brain development and myelination can be affected. Iron deficiency anemia is also implicated as one of the etiological agents in stroke, etiological, it's more commonly seen in association with febrile convulsions, right? So there are so many unknown mechanisms that are present. This will be your introduction. You can also add a note on Anemia Mukt Bharat. Anemia Mukt Bharat, as a part of Poshan Abhiyan, is trying to correct this level of anemia that is present in our country. So introduction, what you will write, what is anemia? Then why are we worried about anemia? What is the prevalence of anemia in our country? Why are we worried about anemia? And what are we doing to prevent anemia? 4 points. Any question on anemia? Write these 4 points as introduction. Next, iron deficiency. How do you define iron deficiency anemia? All right. So anemia, there are multiple definitions. Stick with WHO definition. When they ask on your OSCE or your practical exam or in your theory, stick to WHO definition. WHO definition, there's a big table in the sixth page if you see. There's no anemia, mild anemia, moderate anemia, different age groups. Remember simple. Don't confuse yourself. Less than 5 years. Correct? After 5 to 11 years, 11 to 14 years, then more than 15 years, then women of reproductive age group, they get married, they become pregnant, they give birth to a child, they become lactating women. Correct? So this is the progression in which your anemia classification will be. So what is anemia? Two numbers. One is 10 and another is 11. Less than 5 years and pregnant women, less than 10 is anemia. Rest every age group, less than 11 is anemia. So less than 5 years and pregnant women, less than 10 is anemia. Rest every age group, less than 11 is anemia. Just like you are remembering two numbers, 10 and 11 for your definition of anemia, remember another two numbers, 7 and 8 for your severity of anemia. Severe anemia, same pregnant women, same less than 5 years age group, if the hemoglobin concentration is less than 7, you call it as severe anemia. Rest all age group less than 8 is severe anemia. If you write this much, this is enough for definition of anemia. When you call it as anemia per se, but depending upon the quantity of hemoglobin, because your definition is quantitative and qualitative problems in hemoglobin concentration within the RBC, right? All right. So you have iron deficiency, you have a child who is coming to you, you are seeing so many children who are coming to you. What is the government doing to prevent that? That is your anemia Mukt Bharat. We have already discussed on anemia Mukt Bharat in a separate video earlier, but I will go through it once again here. So come to the 7th page. Anemia Mukt Bharat. Anemia Mukt Bharat 666, 666 strategy. All right. 666 strategy means 6 people who are going to get benefited, 6 beneficiaries. They have got 6 set of goals and they have 6 institutional mechanisms that they are thinking of that they are thinking of implementing that will promote better well-being, better health in the long term. So 6 goals, 6 beneficiaries, 6 institutional mechanisms. How are they doing that? With all the 666, they are putting out 6 interventions. All right. So with these together, they are putting 6 interventions to the beneficiaries to make sure the iron deficiency anemia gets in control. So what are they? Come to the next page. Eighth page, right? Number 8, correct. So who are the 6 set of beneficiaries? 6 set of beneficiaries, like we discussed in our definition, less than 5 years, 5 to 10 years, 10 to 15 years. Then they become women of reproductive age group, correct? Then they become married and they become pregnant mothers. Then they give birth, they become lactating mothers. Correct? So this progression you remember. Less than 5, 5 to 10, 10 to 15, women of reproductive age group, pregnant and lactating mothers. Right? So 6 set of beneficiaries we have. How are they giving the iron and folic acid supplement? When they are giving iron, they thought they will give folic acid also together. Less than 5 years alone, it is bi-weekly supplementation. After 5 years, it is only weekly supplementation. That is the first point I want you to remember in anemia Mukt Bharat. Okay. Less than 5 years, it's bi-weekly. 2 times a week they are giving. And after 5 years, it is only 1 time a week. How much are they giving? See, again, if you read this, you will become very tired. Chariya. I will tell you simply. 20 mg of iron and 100 microgram of folate for less than 5 years. Then almost double the iron and quadruple your folic acid. 45 milligram of elemental iron and 400 microgram of folic acid. Okay. So 45 milligram of elemental iron. When I say iron, I mean elemental iron. For example, when you see a ferrous sulfate preparation, 20% is elemental iron. So when you are saying, I want to give 4 milligram per kg of iron, you mean to say you are giving 4 milligram per kg of elemental iron in whatever preparation you are seeing. So if you look at the bottle or the syrup bottle, you will be able to see each 5 ml contains 25 mg of elemental iron or 80 mg of elemental iron. So that elemental iron is what you are calculating. All right, not the total content. Remember that. So ferrous sulfate, if you say ferrous sulfate, 20% elemental iron. If you say ferrous fumarate, 33% is elemental iron. So know your preparation, know your elemental iron concentration. If you remember ferrous sulfate, at least it's more than enough. Ferrous sulfate is 20% elemental iron. All right. So coming back to this. So 20 milligram, 45 milligram, 100 microgram folic acid, then 400 microgram of folic acid. Rest all 4 classifications, your 10 to 15, your women of reproductive age group, pregnant and lactating mothers, 60 mg elemental iron. Okay, earlier it was 100, but they found that it was more than the tolerable upper limit, so they reduced it to 60 mg. So it is 60 mg of elemental iron with 500 microgram of folic acid for all of the 4 subgroups. Okay, so let's see once again. Elemental iron is 20 mg, 45 mg, 60 mg. Folic acid is your 100 micrograms, 400 micrograms, 500 micrograms. 500 micrograms for rest 4 groups. Pregnant and lactating alone, just one point I want to add. Pregnant mothers, they start iron from 14 weeks of gestation till end. Lactating mothers, first 6 months. This is the duration of supplementation. All right. Rest, there's no duration. Till they are in the particular age group, they are going to continue to receive. So these are the beneficiaries. What are the goals? Goals, again, from 2016 as the base point, they set a goal that by the next 6 years, here also again a six. They're obsessed with number six. Okay, Anemia Mukti Bharat is six. So from 2016, for the next 6 years, they wanted to reduce the prevalence of anemia by 3% every year. So that by 2022, they want an 18% reduction in the baseline prevalence at 2016. This point alone, you remember. If you can remember every percentage, then great. You are great. I cannot. I remember only this much. From 2016, next 6 years, they want to reduce it by total 18%. By that, I mean every year, 3% reduction for the next 6 years. So by 2022, they want an 18% reduction in prevalence of anemia from what existed in 2016. Then what are the six interventions? Six interventions, iron folic acid supplementation, deworming. Correct? Huh? So biannual deworming they give. Apart from that, what else? Is this enough? No. They are trying to fortify foods. Iron folic acid fortified foods are being given so that it is going to provide extra iron. I think approximately 18 mg of elemental iron will come. If you are 18 or 13 or let me see. I'm very bad with numbers, you know. Okay, let's see. It's in the next page. So by iron folic acid supplementation, they are trying to give extra iron apart from what they are receiving as supplementation. Then despite all this, if somebody is going to become anemic, you need to have a method to detect that anemia, correct? So they are trying to test anemia using digital methods. And if found to be anemic, they will be treated at treatment doses. Treatment doses, again, people are very poor in remembering doses. So what they suggest is, for operational convenience, double the prophylactic dose and give to them. You can monitor after 2 to 4 weeks. If there is no improvement, then think about iron refractory iron deficiency anemia or something else. If it is improving, then you can give it for 3 months. All right. So this is your testing for anemia and treatment. And you also have something called as non-nutritional anemia. There are certain pockets where there's something else that's causing the anemia, like a malaria, like a hemoglobinopathy. So in those pockets, you detect that specific type of anemia and treat them differently. So basically, they want anemia to come down. We are talking more about iron because iron deficiency anemia is the most common cause of all the anemias. That's all. So the intervention is prophylactic iron folic acid, deworming, food fortification. Apart from that, if somebody is going to be anemic, you need some method to test and treat them. And the treatment is mandatory provision of iron folic acid and fortified foods, especially in government-funded programs. And in endemic pockets, where there is going to be a non-nutritional anemia, that will be detected and treated according to the underlying cause. These are the six interventions. Six institutional mechanisms, they want to bring together multiple ministries and they want to work together. So work together with what? They want to work together on the Anemia Mukt Bharat program. And they need to have a research base to find out newer methods to identify anemia, newer methods to treat anemia better, right? So, and they want to ultimately make sure there's a common source for the health professional to go refer and treat patients. So they want a common medium to do that, digital portal to do that. And ultimately, if everything has to work properly, the logistics chain has to be proper from the manufacturer, from the transport to reaching the government setup. So that logistic chain has to work. These are the six institutional mechanisms. I'm not talking some story. These are the six interventional and institutional mechanisms. Okay. So convergence of other ministries. You want interministerial coordination. You don't want them to fight. You want them to work together. Right. You want them to work together on your Anemia Mukti Bharat and you want them to establish a good advanced research center on anemia control. Then you want to have a proper logistics chain and you want to have a one-stop digital portal where people can refer on management of anemia. Correct? So this is six institutional mechanisms. Doctor, doc, la, class on approach to arrhythmia. Approach to arrhythmia can be taken, but that has to be pre-recorded and posted, or a live Zoom class has to be taken. I'll try to do that. Telegram group name is Pediatric Takes by Dr. Pavitra on Telegram. Right. So these are the 6666. Okay. So six set of beneficiaries, six set of goals. You have six institutional mechanisms to provide six interventions. These are the Anemia Mukt Bharat. This is what we discussed in the last class also. This is the nutshell. Okay. So each intervention, if you want to talk about Naka, prophylactic iron folic acid supplementation, we talked about deworming. Is going to be biannual deworming. Biannual deworming is going to be done till 15 years of age. Okay. So six months to 5 years, 5 to 10 years, 10 to 15 years, biannual deworming will be done. All right. And testing of anemia using digital methods and treatment, what you will write. So point of care testing, it's yet to be approved by WHO. So we are still sticking with the age-old conventional methods. And for treatment, we talk that it's going to be double the dose of prophylactic iron. Then mandatory provision of iron folic acid, fortified foods. See, fortified foods, they are trying to bring it into rice and cereals. But let's see how it's going to work. So extra 12 mg of elemental iron, page 8, last before paragraph, if you see, it's given. So food fortification, iron fortified rice and other cereals for young children, and using micronutrient powders, etc. So that will give extra 12 mg of elemental iron apart from what they are receiving as your supplementation. Then what else you want? Behavioral change communication. This intervention I didn't talk about at all, right? So see, whatever you give, you need to impress upon them the importance of continuing the treatment. Otherwise, there's going to be defaulters, right? On an average, if you see, when you prescribe some iron folic acid supplementation, only 30% are compliant due to multiple reasons. So they want to impress upon the public the importance of continuing, importance of having anemia and what implications it will have on their life. So behavior change communication aims at dietary diversification also, apart from education, right? So they include 3 G's. If somebody asks what is a 3G in Anemia Mukt Bharat or behavior change communication part of improvement of anemia, 3G is gram, grain, greens. Okay, so what are they? Grams, your Bengal gram, dals. Okay, so gram, grains, greens. Tamil, it's easy for me to say thovaram parpu, kadala parpu, ulutham parpu. In English, it's I'm slightly weak, which is what it, that's why I just stopped with gram. So gram, grain, green, then nuts, dry fruits, along with vitamin C and heme iron. So if you take all of those, it'll improve the iron concentration. What is to be avoided is your coffee, tea, and phytates. So they decrease the absorption of iron. So despite all this, why are we having a practical problem in improvement of the iron status in the population or anemia in the population? So this can be a question. So what are the setbacks for your Anemia Mukt Bharat or iron fortification program? So what might prevent it from improving? So come to the next page. So this again, you can remember it like a story. All right. So what sort of story? Let's see. All right. So government, they basically give this private land, they generally are not included in the umbrella of iron folic acid supplementation. All right. And they are not adequately sensitized also. So government setup, they give. Private setup, they don't know and they don't give. Government setup, if they have to give, they have to get iron from the factory. So that sometimes is affected. And when it comes also, it has to be properly manufactured in the proper way. Earlier, they used to give entry-coated tablet, but entry-coated tablet had lower bioavailability. So they are switching over to sugar-coated tablet, which has a better bioavailability. So this, if you give also, compliance is only 30%. Why the compliance is 30%? Because one, they are not as well educated. And two, it's not a very gastric-friendly drug. More gastritis, vomiting, bloating. So all those things prevent them from continuing the supplement that you are going to give. And even if they take, again, the improvement in hemoglobin is not that great. Why? Because WHO recommends ideally daily supplementation of iron, especially in less than 5 years age group. பட் வாட் வி ஆர் டூயிங் இங்க என்ன பை வீக்லியே வி ஆர் ஹேவிங் ட்ரபிள் வேர் ஆர் வி கோயிங் டு கிவ் டெய்லி டெய்லி அயன் டு பீப்புள் ஹூ இஸ் கோயிங் டு மானிட்டர் தட் ரைட் சோ பை வீக்லி அயன் இஸ் நாட் எனஃப் டு இம்ப்ரூவ் தி அயன் ஸ்டேட்டஸ் இன் தி பாப்புலேஷன் தட் இஸ் ஒன் திங் அண்ட் அனதர் ஈவன் இஃப் தே டேக் அ ப்ராப்பர் அயன் சப்ளிமெண்டேஷன் யூ நீட் டு அட்வைஸ் தம் ஹவு டு டேக் இட் ஆல் ரைட் சோ ஐடியலி பிஃபோர் ஃபுட் ஹாஃப் அன் அவர் பிஃபோர் ஃபுட் ஆர் அட்லீஸ்ட் டூ ஹவர்ஸ் ஆஃப்டர் ஃபுட் அண்ட் what sort of food should be avoided and what sort of food should be taken with iron see if you see iron gets absorbed better if there is a vitamin c okay so vitamin c la if you ask can I take amla compared to amla guava improves the absorption of iron okay 100 grams of guava definitely absorbs the iron of better compared to that of amla taken along with iron the ratio of any vitamin c to iron should be 4:1 What is to be avoided is your phytates. Phytates are your greens, green leafy vegetables. Your tannins, tea, coffee. Those will decrease the absorption of iron. So what should be the ratio of phytate to iron? It should be 0.4:1. 0.4 of phytate and 1 of iron. All right. So if you have that much, the iron absorption is better compared to a higher concentration of phytates. So got my point. So these are all some of the things despite having a robust program why the prevalence is still prevailing right so why the prevalence is still prevailing these are some of the reasons so let's go through that so let's go through the extra points so first point iron supply is irregular and not uniform we discussed private people are not adequately sensitized we discussed compliance is only 30% we discussed then daily iron supplementation but here we are not giving daily iron supplementation we discussed then what else the 100 instead of 100 milligram we are giving 60 milligram elemental iron because it was more than the tolerable upper limit that point also we discussed sugar coated tablets are being given instead of enteric coated we discussed then 90% of oral iron intake is unabsorbed this is an extra point okay so extra point in the sense see the unbound iron now it is going to provide oxidative stress so due to this we do not give iron in the acute management of severe acute malnutrition only when the acute phase is over then we start giving iron supplementation right so first 2 weeks we generally do not give iron in severe acute malnutrition this is the reason and then fecal iron is inversely proportional to that of fecal lactobacilli so this suggests unhealthy gut microbiome again is a very very important emerging topic gut microbiome respiratory microbiome then corollary of your gut microbiome will be your antibiotic associated dysbiosis that again can be a short notes for you guys so if you find time try to go through that all right then higher doses of iron supplementation during pregnancy is linked to gestational diabetes so we are stopped after a ceiling then it's not a gastric friendly drug we discussed vitamin c how much to take phytates how much we should not take we discussed then food fortification is important point of care testing yes then iron refractory anemia infections H. pylori so these are all things that will hinder iron absorption apart from your regular causes your food related causes that is so these are all the factors that are going to hinder the anemia mukt bharat's progression so we discussed many questions here the introduction for any sort of anemia and iron deficiency anemia we discussed then anemia mukt bharat we discussed in detail then what are the fallacies or what are the shortcomings or setbacks to the existing program we discussed so three questions two and a half you can say right so this is about the first article next one let's discuss about autoimmune hemolytic anemia it's in page 18 correct right so page 18 autoimmune hemolytic anemia have you guys flipped your pages hope you have so autoimmune hemolytic anemia they can ask autoimmune hemolytic anemia per se they can ask management of an autoimmune hemolytic anemia or a specific type they can ask warm antibody cold antibody primary secondary they can ask drug induced autoimmune hemolytic anemia these are some of the things that I can think off the top of my head all right so autoimmune hemolytic anemia so what introduction will you be writing autoimmune as the name suggests autoantibodies against the rbc antigens destroy the RBCs, resulting in hemolysis. That results in anemia. That's all. That will be your introduction. You can write, apart from that, incidence is 1 in 1 lakh. Then males are affected more than females, not otherwise around. Okay. So boys are more commonly affected than girls. Then classification of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So these three points in your introduction. Autoimmune, as the name suggests, autoimmune, autoantibodies against RBCs results in hemolysis, which results in anemia. Males more than females, 1 in 1 lakh population. It's not a very common disorder. It's slightly more rare sort of disorder. Classification wise, it can be either acute or chronic, and it can be primary or secondary. So what is acute? What is chronic? Please write this down. Okay. So acute is more of a transient type. Lasts for 3 to 6 months. They occur more in 2 to 12 years age group. 70 to 80% present as acute autoimmune hemolytic anemia. All right. So onset here again can be acute. Acute hemolysis, however, how it presents. It presents with pallor. It presents with jaundice. They can present with cardiac failure, hemoglobinuria if it's going to be an intravascular variety. Right. Spleen can be enlarged. And spleen is the site of destruction of RBCs. So this is your acute transient type. Treatment will be glucocorticoids, and it has got a good response to glucocorticoids. Consistent response and a low mortality rate, better prognosis and full recovery. These are the points for your acute autoimmune hemolytic anemia. 2 to 12 years age group, 3 to 6 months duration, presents acutely, then with like any other hemolytic anemia. Spleen is the site of destruction. They have got a good prognosis because they have got a consistent response to glucocorticoids, and recovery is good. What about chronic? Chronic is common in infancy and more than 12 years. So this is 2 to 12 years. No, less than 2 years, more than 12 years. You remember. And as the name suggests, chronic, it can go on for months or years. It does not have a consistent response to glucocorticoids. And the recovery or prognosis is variable depending upon the type, and they can have involvement of other blood elements like your platelets especially. What do you call autoimmune hemolytic anemia with immune thrombocytopenia combination? What is the name of the syndrome? Can anybody tell me? Let me see who is answering. So there's something called as a autoimmune hemolytic anemia along with your immune thrombocytopenia. So the combination of these two is called by some syndrome. Correct. Dr. Srinivas is absolutely right. It's Evans syndrome. E-V-A-N-S. The Evans syndrome. So this is one classification. The other classification is your primary, secondary. Primary, as the name suggests, it's idiopathic, does not have a specific reason, and idiopathic is more common in adults. Secondary is secondary to something. Infection, it can be immune related disorders like your SLE, juvenile idiopathic arthritis. It can be secondary to your hematological malignancies. It can be secondary to your lymphoreticular malignancies. Sometimes primary immunodeficiency disorders. So these are all the secondary causes. Drugs. I forgot that. Drugs. Right? So these are all the secondary causes of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Secondary is more common in pediatric age group. So this is the second sort of classification. Third sort of classification is depending on the temperature at which the RBC is, you know, agglutinated and hemolyzed. So it can be a warm hemolytic anemia, it can be a cold hemolytic anemia, or it can be a mixed hemolytic anemia. Okay. Cold has two varieties, your cold agglutinin variety and your paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. Just a second. My laptop is about to die. And I don't know why this one's not working. Right. Where were we? Classification. So, introduction, you will say autoimmune hemolytic anemia, you will expand. 1 in 1 lakh, males more than females. Okay. Then classification, acute, chronic. What are the differences? Primary, secondary. What are the differences? Then warm, cold, and mixed varieties. So, this will be your classification. Let's see about each of them one by one. Where should I start? Cold agglutinin disease. Classification like this. Fine. Right. So the first page of the autoimmune hemolytic anemia, the right column, top paragraph. So warm immune hemolytic anemia is more common in children compared to cold hemolytic anemia. In fact, 60 to 90% of childhood autoimmune hemolytic anemia is warm hemolytic anemia. It's characterized by IgG antibodies. It does not require complement for hemolysis. So remember that. Complement can be found. The C3b component can be found, but it does not require the complement per se for hemolysis in the RBCs. All right. So what is the antigen here? Antigen that they have found is mostly Rh antigen in warm autoantibodies. All right. Rh antigen. IgG autoantibodies, this results in extravascular hemolysis. So whenever there's an extravascular hemolysis, you will not have a hemoglobinuria. Okay, hemoglobinuria is characteristic of intravascular hemolysis. Extravascular, there is more of a splenomegaly, jaundice, spherocytes will be seen in peripheral blood smear. So see, immune hemolytic anemia. So suppose, let's take, I'm slightly going off topic, but let's discuss this. Suppose you have a neonate who's coming to you with anemia. Okay, so this pallor, there's some jaundice, and you see in the peripheral smear that there is spherocytes. Okay, so there are spherocytes, and you are not sure whether it's a immune mediated spherocytosis or it's hereditary spherocytosis. You do not have a forthcoming family history. How do you differentiate based upon peripheral smear? Whether it's a immune-mediated spherocyte or a hereditary spherocytosis. Let's see. Just think about it. If you can answer in the comment section, then fine. If not, think about it and write it in the pediatric text group. I'll post the answer in pediatric text. All right. So this is about warm antibody. Cold, again, is divided into cold agglutinin and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. So cold agglutinin disease, see, cold agglutinin is after post-infectious. All right. Dr. Tanuja, Dr. Srinivas, question was peripheral smear. I am not talking about the RBC indices. RBC indices, I am not talking at all. I'm talking about peripheral smear. You are seeing spherocytes. How do you know whether it is immune or hereditary spherocytosis is the question. So it's post-infectious. What infection? Mycoplasma and Epstein-Barr virus, infectious mononucleosis. These are the two things. So two infections can result in cold agglutinin disease. Here it's IgM autoantibodies and they require complement for hemolysis. Why is it called as cold? Because it attaches to RBCs. The hemolysis happens at a cold temperature. What is the antigen here? Antigen is I antigen. Okay, so capital I antigen, not the small I antigens. Just like you have capital D, small d in your Rh, capital C, small c in your Rh. Similarly, you have capital I and small I antigen. So this is directed against the capital I antigen. That's why if you see newborns, cord blood, this does not cause hemolysis because the small I concentration is more compared to that of capital I concentration. This is just a point of interest, not for your theory. You need not know this, but still. So this is about cold agglutinin. Paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, it is rare. That is the Donnet-Landsteiner antibody. It is IgG. It's not IgM. It is IgG antibody. What is the antigen here? P antigen. P for Pavitra. Okay, so Pavitra antigen on RBCs. So they bind to RBCs at a lower temperature. When the temperature of the RBC raises to 37 degrees Celsius, then it causes hemolysis. So these are the three varieties of autoimmune hemolytic anemia depending upon the temperature. So then come to the next page where you have the classification: warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, cold agglutinin disease, paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. Etiology I will not be going through because we just now discussed that. One point that I would like to tell is whenever you find thrombocytopenia in a warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Okay, so you think of Ivan syndrome, yes. Whenever you see a Ivan syndrome, you should always think of ruling out ALPS. Okay, autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome. So that's usually associated. You should be ruling out ALPS if you find a Ivan syndrome in a warm autoantibody hemolytic anemia. Right. So autoantibody we discussed. Warmla IgG, coldla it is IgM. Then paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria IgG. What is the antigen? Warmla it's usually Rh. They are still trying to find out. 70% they think it is Rh. Then in cold it is I antigen. And paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria it is P antigen. Coombs test if you do. Coombs test la in warm AIHA you have at 37 degrees IgG positivity. C3 may or may not be present. So that's not important for pathogenesis. When do you have a Coombs positivity per se? Does every autoimmune or immune hemolytic anemia has a Coombs positivity? Need not be. It depends upon how much IgG coats the RBC. Write down this point. This is not given in the table here or the theory. So you need at least 260 to 400 immunoglobulin G coating the RBC surface in order for you to have a positive Coombs test. That's why if you have a positive Coombs test, it's a true positive. You know there's an immune hemolytic component. But if it's negative, you cannot take it at face value when you have a strong clinical suspicion. So positive is a true positive for Coombs test. Why is it a true positive? Because you need at least 260 to 400 immunoglobulin Gs coating the RBC surface, resulting in a hemolytic anemia. Next, cold agglutinin disease. See, cold agglutinin disease, you will not have IgM. IgG you will definitely not have because IgG is not in the pathogenesis of cold agglutinin disease. But why not IgM? IgM you don't see here because IgM gets washed out when you prepare the cells for a Coombs test. Okay. So there are certain preparatory steps that are required to do a Coombs test. And when you do that, IgM gets washed out. That is why you do not have IgM positivity. You will have a complement positivity. C3 positivity will be present. Paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, depending upon the temperature. At 37 degrees Celsius, your IgG will not be there. C3 will be positive. At 4 degrees Celsius, both will be positive. So remember that. Treatment-wise, warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, just like any other autoimmune condition, corticosteroids are the first line of management. Second line of management will be your IVIG rituximab. And last step is splenectomy. Cold agglutinin disease and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, what is the inciting factor here? It is cold, no? So simplest thing for you to do is avoid cold. If you don't go into cold, you're not going to have a hemolysis, correct? So cold avoidance is the first line of therapy. Second line of therapy will be rituximab and plasmapheresis in cold agglutinin disease because infection-induced autoantibodies, they can remove off via plasmapheresis. Paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria, corticosteroids are the second line of management. Clinical presentation. In page 19, below the table, you see clinical presentation. Intravascular or extravascular. Warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia is extravascular. Cold agglutinin is an intravascular hemolysis. So whenever you have an extravascular hemolysis, you will see anemia, of course. Jaundice you will see. Splenomegaly you will see. Intravascular hemolysis, apart from your anemia and jaundice, you will have hemoglobinuria. Remember that. So intravascular hemolysis is more of a cold agglutinin and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. And extravascular is warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Remember that point. And they can present with features of severe anemia and congestive cardiac failure. So that's about your clinical presentation. Then come to the next page. You have differential diagnosis. Differential diagnosis, all of you will be able to write. Okay, so any hemolytic anemia will be your differential diagnosis, right? So your child is presenting to you with hemolysis. Now, autoimmune is not going to be the first thing that's off the top of your head, your first diagnosis. Unless you have a child who has features suggestive of systemic lupus erythematosus, features suggestive of a malignancy, features suggestive of a JIA or an infection like mycoplasma, then no, that's not going to be your first diagnosis, right? So what will be your first thinking? Your thought process will be a G6PD deficiency, spherocytosis or a hemolytic uremic syndrome. How are you going to differentiate these things? G6PD, there will be some drug consumption prior to the onset of hemolysis. There may or may not be a family history. Hemolytic uremic syndrome, you will have, apart from anemia, what you will have? Uremia. Renal dysfunction will be present. You can have thrombocytopenia, right? And hypertension can be present in hemolytic uremic syndrome. Pure red cell aplasia, it's progressive anemia and it's usually seen after solid organ transplantation. Malignancy, ALPS, infections, you will have corresponding history. So depending upon that, that's why history and examination is very, very important whenever you are managing any patient. Does not matter this, that, for everything, if you take a proper history and examination, your answer is there. It's not in your investigations. It's not in your imaging. It's in your history and examination. Remember that. The differential diagnosis, fine. Investigations, what are you going to do? A child is coming to you with anemia and jaundice. You're obviously thinking of hemolysis. So what will you do? You will do a CBC. You will do a peripheral smear. You will do a retic culture. If you're thinking of immune component, you will do a Coombs test. Correct? So these will be your first two tests. Then you want to know whether it is intravascular or extravascular. How will you do that? You want to look for hemoglobinuria. So you will do a urine analysis. Correct? Then you want to rule out the differential diagnosis that you thought of. Differential diagnosis, what you think? You thought of hemolytic uremic syndrome. So you want to do a renal function test. So do a renal function test. You want to do a liver function test, or at least specifically a bilirubin, to see how high the bilirubin is and how far the bilirubin has risen. Then lactate dehydrogenase, aspartate aminotransferase are supportive tests. And underlying disorder, if you suspect something, you will go ahead and work up for that specific disorder. So these are your investigations. Cold agglutinin titers alone, one word I will add. Cold agglutinin titers, you will do if you're suspecting a cold agglutinin disease secondary to mycoplasma or EBV. What are you going to do? You will be diluting the blood. So more the dilution happens, lesser the content of your cold agglutinins, right? So you want to see what is the maximum diluted blood that is actually causing RBC agglutination. So that will be documented. If this titer is higher than 1 in 256, then that is significant. Then that is specific for your cold agglutinin disease. That is typically seen in your cold agglutinin disease. And the rest of the investigations, if you know the etiology, you can write for everything. SLE, you will think and write. JIA, you will think and write. Malignancy, if you're suspecting, you will do a bone marrow aspiration and a defined biopsy. Right. So each and everything you will write. Treatment-wise, emergency measures and then specific measures. Emergency measures, blood transfusion, you will do only if it is a severe anemia or there is organ dysfunction. Organ dysfunction, I mean congestive cardiac failure. So only in these two situations, because typing and crossing a patient with autoimmune hemolytic anemia is very, very difficult. They are going to react with, cross-react with every blood that you are going to check up against. So you need to know what was the initial blood typing of that patient. In case of severe anemia secondary to warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, give pulse methylprednisolone therapy. How much are you going to give? 30 mg per kg to a maximum of 1 gram can be given. If it's a cold agglutinin disease, then plasmapheresis and rituximab should be considered if they are presenting to you acutely. All right. Then always expect severe hemolytic reactions, especially in cold reactive autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So always warm the blood before you are transfusing in a patient whom you suspect to have a cold agglutinin disease. Why? Because agglutination hemolysis happens only at low temperature. No, why do you want that? Warm the blood and then transfuse. Simple. You avoid that problem. Okay. But do not withhold blood transfusion, especially in a decompensated autoimmune hemolytic anemia, just because you are unable to, you know, appropriately match the blood. Various steps in management, box 2, if you see glucocorticoids, rituximab, IVIG. So any autoimmune disorder, you will typically have this set of management box, right? So same thing applies for autoimmune hemolytic anemia also. Just one point, okay, we'll finish off specific measures and then we will come to drug-induced autoimmune hemolytic anemia. All right. So glucocorticoids, next page, Naka 23. Specific measures in warm reactive autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Glucocorticoid is the cornerstone of treatment. Even after therapy, remember that direct Coombs test can be weakly positive. That does not mean that the treatment is not effective. All right. So glucocorticoids are important. You will start with 1 to 2 milligram per kg per day. So if the patient is poorly compliant, not taking orally, then IV methylprednisolone can be given. Steroid tapering should be slow. It should be over 6 months. You expect the, you know, problem to resolve by 3 to 6 months in case of a acute onset autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And the patient will be serially monitored to see if the patient is responding or not. Second line therapy. If the patient, next paragraph. Second line therapy, when do you start? you start if the child is not responding to your steroids. When do you say no response? Within 1 to 2 months of initiation, you see that the child is not in clinical remission, not improving the hemoglobin or RBC count. Then you want to initiate second line therapy. Also, in patients who require high doses of prednisolone, you do not want steroid-induced effects. Right, so rituximab is the preferred second-line therapy. How much is given? 375 milligram per meter square. Intravenous infusion should be given over 3 hours, once a week for 4 weeks. 375 milligram per meter square, once a week for 4 weeks. This is the second-line therapy. When do you give second-line therapy? If the patient requires high dose of steroids or not responding to steroids by 1 to 2 months of initiation. Okay. Then high dose IVIG also can be used, but only transient response is seen. Other steroid sparing agents, other immunosuppressive drugs can be used. Some point I wanted to tell, no? Right. So lupus, which immunosuppressive agent is preferred? Azathioprine and MMF. The right side column, second paragraph. Several immunosuppressive agents. So that paragraph. In a lupus patient with warm autoantibody hemolytic anemia, azathioprine and mycophenolate mofetil is preferred. Whereas in an autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome, sirolimus is preferred compared to rituximab. If it's a drug-induced autoimmune hemolytic anemia, stop the offending drug. Short course of oral prednisolone can be started. Some of the newer drugs are alemtuzumab, which is a CD52 antibody. Then bortezomib. Yes, bortezomib, proteasome inhibitor. Ofatumumab. It's again a monoclonal antibody to CD20. So these are the newer medications for autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Plasmapheresis, more used in cold agglutinin disease, cold reactive autoantibody anemia. So generally, they do not present with too much anemia because our body temperature is 37 degrees. It's warm. So it's not going to cause anemia. If at all they're going to present acutely, you will do a plasmapheresis. You can give azithromycin for treatment of mycoplasma pneumonia. So let's talk a little bit about drug-induced hemolytic anemia. See, drug-induced hemolytic anemia, in case they ask this question, I need you to know at least 2-3 points. So drug-induced hemolytic anemia can happen by 3 mechanisms. One is a hapten. Hapten mechanism is, see, RBC is there. RBC antigens are there. And on top of that, the drug sits. And the antibody comes and sits on the drug. So this is a immune mechanism, not an autoimmune mechanism. Remember that. So this is an immune mechanism, not autoimmune. Autoantibody is not against the RBC antigen here. It's against the hapten. So classical example is your penicillin. The hemolysis that happens is extravascular. So these are all points not given in this article. It's from Nelson. So please note it down. So one mechanism is hapten mechanism. So hapten mechanism is immune mediated, not autoimmune mediated. Autoantibodies against the drug, IgG antibody. It's an extravascular hemolysis. Example is penicillin. Next is immune complex mediated mechanism. So immune complex, again, there's RBC, there's the receptor. You have the drug coming and sitting here. The antibody that is formed, it forms a ternary complex with RBC antigen, your drug, right, and antibody. So they form together a ternary complex. So here, anti-C3 is positive, anti-complement 3 is positive. The hemolysis is intravascular. It's an intravascular hemolysis. Cephalosporin, quinidine is a classical example. Okay, so quinidine, quinine is generally quoted as the classical example for immune complex mediated hemolysis. The third mechanism is true autoantibody formation. Okay, so true autoantibody formation against the RBC antigen because this drug confuses our system. Classical example is methyl dopa. The antigen is IgG. IgG naka, it's extravascular. Okay, so extravascular hemolysis happens. Methyl dopa. Most common drug causing a immune hemolysis is cephalosporin. Remember, don't write penicillin. most common cause of a drug-induced immune hemolytic anemia is cephalosporin. So these are the points I wanted to talk about in drug-induced hemolytic anemia. Treatment will be to stop the offending agent and give a short course of prednisolone 1 to 2 mg per kg. So that's it. I think we have covered autoimmune hemolytic anemia also. My son is already back and I think we should say bye-bye. Any doubts? I'll take your doubts now. Tomorrow, let's see what we'll be discussing. In leukemia, there's not much given. You can go through it yourself. It's not very complicated. It's what you read in pathology. So I think that should be fine. Thrombocytopenia, it's an interesting read of different case scenarios and how it was managed. Automated analyzer based approach to anemia. I'm not sure if this will be asked, but if this is asked, unless you read this, you will not be able to write anything. So I think we'll just have an overview at least of automated analyzer based approach to anemia. Then clotting factor replacement therapy. Yes, that's again an important topic. Factor 8, factor 9 replacement. I will try to do that. At least for FFP factor 8 factor in the important ones, cryoprecipitate. Hey, HSCT, hematopoietic stem cell transplant. That's an important topic, no? All right, so tell you what, I will do hematopoietic stem cell transplant and the automated analyzer based approach to anemia. So these two are slightly more drier and vague topics. So I will cover these two tomorrow. Okay, so if there are no doubts, bye-bye. If you have any doubts, you can post in our Telegram group and I'll definitely answer. Okay, so take care. All the best. Study well. Take some time off also to relax. Okay, so only if you have a good mindset, you'll be able to achieve your goals for the day. Bye-bye.